private equity investment in law firms. There are even law firms in the UK that are publicly listed on the stock exchange. The first one, which started in Australia, is called Slater and Gordon. If you'd put a dollar in Slater and Gordon in 2007, you would have done better than the S&P 500, better than the FTSE, better than the DAX, better than Goldman Sachs, better than almost anything you can name, which should suggest to you the venture capitalist who's backing Ralph's son's venture, or at least the one who gave the angel investor, she spoke. The head of LegalZoom spoke, and we had about 30 companies, startups, who were interested in the legal services space. And they came in four varieties, all of which I think should be interesting to people in this room. So, first, serving the underserved through some combination of do-it-yourself plus. This is basically LegalZoom's model, right? It makes forms available, it makes information available, and then the plus is it offers some access where you could get access to a real lawyer. I actually invited John So to this conference. He couldn't come. If you've never heard the LegalZoom guys, or you only think it's just Robert Shapiro doing schlecky commercials, you should check out what they're doing. They are some of the most sophisticated people I have ever met, and they are moving. Their model is moving very fast. Second, there are people who are taking technology to streamline tests that all lawyers use. So how many people know RavelLaw? Yeah, I know Martha does, because we just have a very important partnership with RavelLaw. RavelLaw is an online, it started out as a better way to do legal research than Lexis or Nexus. It's much more pictorial, it links things together. My students love
seeing me is a different story, but I'll enjoy seeing you.
Thank you. Oh, he's taller than I am. No, it's cool. Yep. Diane is shorter. Yep.
Is that better for
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Check. Testing. One. Check. Testing. One, two, three. Okay.
Good evening. I'm Jonathan Fanton, president of the American Academy, and it's my pleasure to welcome you and to call to order the 2027th stated meeting of the American Academy. This is the first distinguished Morton Mandel annual public program established through a donation from the Jack Joseph and Morton Mandel Foundation based in Cleveland, Ohio. It's part of the Morton Mandel Program for Civic Discourse and Membership Engagement, which aims to strengthen the bonds of community among the Academy's 4,600 fellows as we stimulate discussion of important issues with the general public. Morton Mandel was elected a member of the Academy in 2011. Chair and chief executive of Packwood LLC, he well understands the original aim of the Academy, and I quote from one of our founding documents, to cultivate every art and science which may tend to advance the interest, honor, dignity, and happiness of a free, independent, and virtuous people. That's what we're about. In making his gift, Morton Mandel said he wanted, and I quote, to expand and enhance the impact of the American Academy on how we think about ourselves in America and how we set our priorities. So we're enormously grateful to Mort for his generosity. This event is being live streamed, so Mort, if you're watching, let's give a round of applause of appreciation. Recognizing the importance of the conversation we're about to have this evening, we are streaming the initial panel discussion to a group of our members gathered in four locations, New York, Washington, Chicago, and Berkeley. And when our panel concludes its presentation, and at that point we'll open it up to a general conversation, engaging all of you here, members at the four other locations will break away and have their own conversations. So I want to thank Mark Kaplan for hosting the group at the New York offices of Skadden Arps, for David Zornow, a global head of litigation at Skadden, for moderating the conversation there. I'd like also to thank Diana White, executive director of the Legal Assistance Foundation, for moderating in Chicago, Jane Aiken, vice dean at Georgetown, for moderating in Washington, and David Oppenheimer, professor of law at Berkeley, for moderating the discussion in California. So thanks to all. Our program this evening concludes the first day of a two-day symposium here at the Academy on the state of legal services for low-income Americans. The symposium's been organized by John Levy, chair of the Legal Services Corporation, Lance Liebman, the Beinecke Professor of Law at Columbia, and Martha Minow, dean of the Harvard Law School. The symposium has gathered together a distinguished group of participants, most of them here, in this room tonight, federal and state judges, scholars, and legal aid providers among them, all of whom are concerned that we as a nation are failing the American citizens most in need of legal assistance. By some estimates, only 20% of Americans who qualify for legal aid receive the kind of support and services they require. That's a shocking number. But our meeting today gave me some hope. We explored a range of remedies from increasing pro bono work for students and law firms to mobilizing retired lawyers to using technology in creative ways to help people navigate the court system. So I came away from a day-long conversation believing that it is possible to make access to justice much more widely and fairly available in our country, and that the will to do so is growing. Both the commitment, the imagination, and the will. Our topic this evening has been an interest and concern of the American Academy for many decades. Even before the provision of legal services for low-income Americans became a federal priority in the late 1960s, Academy fellow Paul Freund, an American jurist and law professor, wrote in a 1963 issue of our journal, Daedalus, that, and I quote, the provision of legal aid to the indigent is a necessary philanthropic service. Like any profession which considers its function to serve the public, Freund wrote, the legal profession must strive for and will be measured by three standards: its independence, its availability, and its learning. Well, the Academy has since sought to evaluate these three standards, focusing on Freund's first standard of independence. In 2008, the Academy published an issue of Daedalus entitled On Judicial Independence, with articles by Sandra Day O'Connor, Judith Resnick, and Margaret Marshall, who was here today, which spoke to the importance of free and independent courts. In 2014, another issue of Daedalus looked at Freund's standard of learning. That publication, entitled The Invention of Courts, helped us better understand the legal system in this country and its issues. And we'll push further into that standard next month when we have a stated meeting at Georgetown on the crisis in legal education. But tonight we will address the third of Freund's standards, availability. To do so, we've gathered a distinguished panel, beginning with our first speaker and moderator, Diane Wood, Chief Judge of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Seventh Circuit. You can find a complete biography of all in your program, but let me just say that Diane is the chair of the Academy's Council and a member of our board. She's also a member of two Academy commissions, our Humanities Commission, recently concluded, and a brand new one on language learning. She's been a critical advisor and partner to me in my first year as your president, and I am personally grateful, Diane, for all your hard work on behalf of the Academy and its members. So after Diane offers some preliminary remarks and introduces our speakers, she will moderate the discussion that follows. So please proceed.
Thank you very much, Jonathan, and I would be remiss if I did not acknowledge the wonderful leadership that Jonathan has provided as our president at the Academy. It has been a true pleasure for all of us to work with him. I also want to give Jonathan credit for the inspiration, or the initial inspiration, for the meeting that brought many of us together today. It was his thought that the Academy should sponsor an exploratory fund so that people with creative ideas about topics, about projects that were worthy of the kind of attention the Academy can give, would have the financial wherewithal to get together and conduct that kind of exploratory process. And the minute Jonathan announced this idea, which was a great idea, John Levy, as he mentioned, the chair of the Legal Services Corporation, approached Jonathan, and one thing led to another, and John and Lance Liebman and Martha worked very hard, along with the members of the Academy staff, to put together this program on making justice accessible. So it's our privilege to really continue, in some ways, the conversation that some of us have been having during the day, and to see what kind of observations we can make about this. As Jonathan mentioned, on the civil side, the number can be disputed, but the unmet need might be as high as 80%, maybe it's quote-unquote only 60% of the people who would benefit from legal services but who do not have the financial ability to acquire them. Any number like that is a huge number, and it's a number that's very damaging to our social fabric. And as we explored today, on the criminal side, the story isn't that much better, and perhaps that might surprise you a little more. We've all seen plenty of TV shows and other sources showing us police officers reading somebody their Miranda rights and telling them that they have a right to a lawyer at public expense should they be unable to afford one. And indeed, people do get lawyers as long as it's not a traffic offense or a misdemeanor that's regarded as too trivial, and as long as they're not an undocumented alien who faces not prison, but what we euphemistically call removal from the country. That's today's word for deportation. But what kind of a lawyer does a person get? If the lawyer has an unmanageable caseload, maybe the lawyer spends 5 minutes before walking into the courtroom and entering a plea. So we talked some about the accessibility to serious legal assistance for those who are committed, who are accused of crime as well. So we have just an outstanding couple of people to talk about this, and what I would like to do is first turn the podium over to Justice Goodwin Liu of the California Supreme Court. The state Supreme Courts play a critical role in the question of accessibility of justice. And after Justice Liu speaks, we will turn over to Judge David Tatel, who is on the United States Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia Circuit. David will continue, and then I will probably take the microphone again and add a few comments of my own. But I refer you to your programs for their full biographies, both of which are distinguished, both of which show deep experience in this field of the accessibility of justice to those who do not have the resources to go out and get good counsel themselves. So Goodwin, would you like to start? Sure.
Thank you, Diane, and thank you to Jonathan Fanton and to the Academy for highlighting this incredibly important topic, all the more important, I think, at the particular juncture of history and where we find the profession today. When you bang the gavel, Jonathan, my natural instinct was to stand up, but then I realized that was just habit. I think that this issue is so important because it's just a simple truth that we can have all the laws and guarantees that we want written on paper, but none of them really mean anything unless they are put into practice. And that gap between what's on paper and what's in practice happens to be a very, very big one in our country. And it need not be that way because there are other nations and other systems of legal service delivery that don't have as big gaps as we do. And so we really need to rethink this, lest the rule of law simply be something we observe in theory and not in real practice. What I want to do, just as a kind of opening set of comments, is offer a descriptive map, if you will, of the loosely levers or domains in which a discussion of this issue falls. This is not the only way you could categorize the discussion, but I'll offer three buckets, basically, for helping us organize the discussion. The first bucket I would call the substantive law of access to justice. And here, I think we should pay attention to aspects, for example, of our civil procedure. And most of my comments will be directed at the civil side, although I know we're going to encompass the criminal side as well in a second. But the fact is that we have a lot of law out there that structures the way litigation proceeds. And the way that is structured affects greatly who can actually get their rights vindicated in court. The most prominent of which you probably read about a lot in the news, is class actions. Class actions have become a hot point of controversy in the law and in the business world. And the federal and state laws that modulate whether or not class actions can or cannot proceed, I think has a huge effect on who can actually get their rights vindicated, especially in the consumer and employment fields. So that's just one example. Another example would be something like fee-shifting statutes. Most of you know, I think, that the American rule is that each side bears their own fees, typically. But sometimes when a legislature wants to incentivize the bringing of particular kinds of claims, they allow fees to be shifted, which means the winning party and the notion of who is a winning party, it's itself a concept in the law that needs to be elaborated, can collect their attorney's fees from the other side. Another big area in this substantive law would be arbitration. Some of you may have seen these big New York Times articles in the last couple weeks about arbitration. Arbitration originated as a mechanism for parties of equal bargaining power, typically merchants, to resolve disputes with low cost, great speed, and achieve all the efficiencies that entails. And now I think we can all recognize that arbitration has become much, much more widely used in situations that perhaps were not originally foreseen a century ago. When you walked into this building, maybe you just gave up all your rights to the American Academy, and they're going to arbitrate everything with you. And for all these strategies, I think, you know, the basic idea is that we have to achieve a balance, right? It's not all one thing or another, but we have to achieve some kind of balance between ensuring legitimate access to justice, access to the legal system, with deterring frivolous litigation and causing waste in the system. And so, you know, different people in the environment have different senses of where that balance lies, but that is one category in which by which we modulate, you know, access to justice. Also in this category, I would just say is that for those of you who are interested in being policymakers, it is just a fact about our particular society that we are a very law dense society. We legalize, I don't mean authorize, but I mean we codify into the law lots and lots of things. Come to California if you want evidence of this. We have statute books that are, you know, as tall as this room. And all of these laws that are passed in the modern era are, of course, well-motivated. They have good intentions, good purposes. But as a whole, they create a system in which the accessibility of law depends increasingly on one's ability to navigate this morass. One example, which may be familiar to you, is the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, IDEA. Very well-intentioned law. I don't think anybody would dispute that's a well-intentioned law. But, you know, the studies of the IDEA will tell you that it creates a situation of the haves and the have-nots, because those who can afford the lawyer and use the procedural mechanisms that are detailed in that statute to achieve the rights guaranteed to kids under the IDEA are just going to, you know, they're just going to have better results than those who cannot find a lawyer to help navigate the same morass. And so you have this sort of density problem that creates inequalities in terms of access. And so that's just a word of caution to people who write laws, is that we may have good intentions behind wanting to write a law, but there are a lot of unintended things that flow from that. Okay, so this is, you know, I would call that one, that this is the first bucket, the substantive law of access to justice. A second bucket is consists of things that you might think of as more conventional reform or initiatives within the legal profession or within law schools. Okay, so using the existing tools of the legal profession, reforming those, reorganizing them, fundamentally working within the four corners of the profession as we understand it today. So we have, for example, in the audience today, the Legal Services Corporation. We have John Levy, we have Jim Sandman, we have people who had long histories with the Legal Services Corporation providing legal services to indigent people, and we have, you know, a history of the LSC with ebbs and flows in terms of how much money it has gotten, what kind of political support it has gotten, the breadth or narrowness of its mission. So we have, you know, a lot of levers that we've used to adjust that particular mechanism. And then we have pro bono efforts. We have pro bono efforts by law firms and individuals. We have state laws that mandate or strongly encourage these kinds of efforts. Some of those are more successful than others, but the idea is that, you know, as part of the profession, we ought to be giving back, especially to communities that are in need. And so we use that lever through exhortation, sometimes through more coercive means. I'm involved in an initiative in California that we've loosely called incubator programs, and these are programs that are designed to capture young law graduates, put them into training programs, essentially to start their own solo or small group practices that serve not necessarily indigent people, but ordinary people. The way I put it is, you know, is there a model of lawyering that ordinary people could afford in the way that ordinary people can afford a plumber? If your toilet is broken, you're going to call a plumber to come fix it. Can we provide legal services for roughly the cost of what people might pay a plumber or an electrician or a car mechanic or somebody that we use in a more habitual way to fix important problems in our lives that we currently don't, we're not habituated to do with lawyers. And there's more. I mean, there's more that we could talk about in terms of you know, pro bono requirements or experiential requirements in law schools and whatnot. But anyway, this is there's a lot of stuff we can talk about within this bucket. The third bucket, and then I'll stop, I'll loosely call economic regulation of the legal profession. And here, the vantage point is to step outside of the four corners of the legal profession to ask more fundamental questions about why the legal profession is structured the way it is. And the way it is structured is, largely speaking, a model that has survived at least a century. We have qualified people who are of one category only, lawyers. And they do all the functions of lawyering. And they typically do it through brick and mortar enterprises in personal interactions in a one-on-one kind of relationship, okay? Contrast this, just to test your intuition, contrast this with medicine, right? The most pronounced thing about medicine, I think, in the contemporary period is the intense differentiation of function with respect to the delivery of healthcare services. Indeed, that industry has proliferated categories of people, doctors, nurse practitioners, technicians of whatever stripe, nurses, differentiated by many different categories, in order to triage your needs to the lowest cost provider who can actually take care of your needs and then only move you up to the next higher cost person if necessary, right? So it would be strange if we had a medical profession or healthcare profession that was just one category, doctors. That's it. All you can see is a doctor. Whatever severity, whatever gravity your problem, only doctors can see. So, you know, law is very different in this way, and one has to ask very fundamental questions about whether or not we are having some serious inefficiencies as a result. To put a finer point on the problem of the scale of legal unmet legal needs out there, some of the work that's been done on this is really quite startling. I'm going to quote some things from a USC law professor named Jillian Hatfield, who's really studied this stuff. So she reports that if you look at legal aid lawyers and you measure all their legal effort against the total denominator of all legal effort in the country, legal aid lawyers contribute 1% of all legal effort that's made in the country each year, 1%. Pro bono, American lawyers average about 30 hours of pro bono work a year. Pro bono is another 2% of total legal effort. Okay, so if you think about that, and she said, well, what if you were to ask every lawyer in America to do 100 more hours of pro bono work a year? I mean, typical lawyer, some of you, you know, lawyers or have the good fortune to be married to a lawyer, you know, in a 1,800 hour or 2,000 hour billing a year, add 100 more years pro bono, what would you get? She says that would be enough to secure less than 30 minutes per problem per household in America. In other words, it's a drop in the bucket. Another way to look at this is that if you look at the average billing rates for lawyers in just modest, you know, solo or small firm practices, you're talking about roughly $200 an hour. This is not white shoe New York firms who charge $5, $6, $7, even $1,000 an hour. This is just, you know, your ordinary lawyer, $200 an hour. If you just took that as the rate, it would cost on the order of $50 billion annually to give 1 hour of legal help to every American household every year. And what do we actually spend on legal aid for such households? Less than 10% of that amount, $3.7 billion, right? $50 billion need, we spend less than $5 billion on the problem. So the point is that we have to figure, we're not gonna engineer our way to a solution that is truly at scale by working within the four corners of how we do law today. We need to figure out how to lower the cost of doing law. And you know, here I think the ideas are very wide-ranging. But I'll just say one thing, which is that I think technology is going to have to be part of the solution. And I'll be careful what I say, because I think the principal regulators of the profession and what is or is not allowed are courts like mine, which are state high courts. And so some of these things will come before me, and I can't go too far in talking about them. But I think the role of technology, the role of different organizational forms, the role of other service providers in the legal profession, not just lawyers. We have to evolve different categories of who can actually help people navigate the legal system. All of these have to be on the table in a serious way if we ever hope to really make a dent in the vast problem that Diane and Jonathan have put before us this evening. So I'll stop there.
Thank you very much, Goodwin. So David. So now David is going to tell us the solution to the problem.
I wish I had it, Diane. Well, to be Goodwin, that was terrific, by the way, and I want to come back to some of the things that Goodwin spoke about. But to be totally candid, when I received the invitation to this conference a couple of months ago, I put it aside. The fact is, I've been attending conferences like this basically since the 60s, when legal services were part of OEO. And all the conferences have almost the same title: improving access to justice, serving the unmet needs of the poor. And over the years, as I've attended these conferences, the situation has gotten worse and worse. And so attending another conference wasn't something really high on my agenda, I have to say. Now, it hasn't always been this way. In the early days of legal services, and in fact, shortly in the years right after the Legal Services Corporation was created, the situation was dramatically different. We had, Jim Sandman gave me these numbers the other day, they're breathtaking. Legal services had, in inflation-adjusted dollars, twice the budget it has today, serving half the number of poor people. In addition to that, there was a network of university-based backup centers that provided technical assistance and expertise in substantive areas like housing, welfare, food, all of the issues that legal services lawyers face. These were the think tanks for legal services lawyers all over the country. And in addition to that, there was a REGI program which funded 250 of some of the smartest law school graduates doing legal services. In fact, in my graduating class at the University of Chicago in 1966, our two top students, the editor of our law review and the fellow who was first in his class, after completing elite federal court clerkships, were Reggies for a few years. In fact, to show you how things have changed, these two friends of mine were Reggies in Chicago, and I was with a large Chicago law firm at the time, and I was working on a pro bono case with them. And this is totally true. Their office in Chicago, in the legal services office, they had a separate office for where they were doing their work. The sign on the door said, OEO Legal Services, Class Action and Test Case Division. Now, if one of Jim's offices put up a sign like that today, Congress would defund legal services faster than it's defunding Planned Parenthood. I mean, legal services then was doing class action and test case litigation. Think about that. And we actually thought at that time, in the late 60s and early 70s, that we were going to solve this problem. That the fact is that that poor people in the country would have equal access to the legal system. We actually thought that that goal was attainable. And here we are today, some 40 years later, and you heard the number from Jonathan, 80% of poor people who need legal services can't get them. In Washington, it's 90%. And in some specific fields, like housing, it's 98%. So all that said, I'm actually very glad I came. First of all, I still haven't figured out how to say no to John Levy. That's number one. And number two, this conference has actually been quite extraordinary. Ideas that have been discussed, and I didn't even get here till late this morning, have been fascinating. Not only have they been focused on the nuts and bolts of legal services, but as you just heard from Goodwin's summary, they've dealt with structural and substantive issues that we really, really need to think about. I was especially setting aside the fact that I'm intrigued with Watson now deciding some of my cases. I was particularly intrigued with the comments of the chief justices of the state chief justices who were here. I haven't heard years ago. I didn't hear that kind of commitment to solving this problem from the leaders of our state courts that I heard today. It was fascinating, and it made me realize that my job is relatively easy compared to theirs. But these are very important ideas we've been discussing, and Jonathan and John and Martha, congratulations for making this happen. I think it's a really important conference. But here's what I want to say. I think we have to be very realistic about this. Even if all of these ideas we've talked about, all of them, bear fruit and turn out to be, we know that they're going to be helpful. We already know that. And we know they will dramatically improve the ability of the legal system to serve the poor. The fact is, and this is my own view, the fact is we are not going to really make a dent in this problem. That is to substantially reduce the number of poor people unserved by the legal system in the short run without dramatically expanding federal, state, and local legal services programs. These are the programs that know how to provide legal services to large numbers of poor people. Pro bono work is terrific, and the Legal Services Corporation's task force on pro bono did an enormous service. In fact, I carry its report everywhere I go, because whenever I speak about pro bono, lawyers say to me, what can I do? I hand them the report. I say, do something here. This lays it out. But the fact is, when you're thinking about serving millions of poor people in routine legal matters, the institution that knows how to do that is federal, state, and local legal services. Now, that's a problem, because Congress isn't going to fund it. In fact, Congressman Kennedy told us at lunch today it's probably going to reduce its funding even further. In my view, there is an institution that is capable of fully funding legal services, and that is responsible for doing it, but that has not stepped up to the plate. And that is the legal profession. Based on some of the comments this afternoon, I'm not sure everybody agrees with me about that, but let me say just a few things about it. First of all, two facts. The latest census data showed that the legal profession grossed 2 years ago $250 billion. $250 billion. 0.15% of that. That is 15 cents for every $100 earned, would double the budget of the Legal Services Corporation and allow it to serve every client they've turned away. And if you think that number is unrealistic, in Washington, some 20 law firms have made financial commitments to local legal services program that come close to that 0.15% commitment. The 100 largest law firms in the country could double the budget of the Legal Services Corporation with contributions of less than 0.5% of their gross revenues. Fact number two, when law firms hire Supreme Court clerks, they give them very large bonuses. You've probably read about them. The 32 clerks a year ago who went to work for law firms, who clerked first on federal appeals courts like Diane and mine's, and then went to the Supreme Court, received almost $12 million in bonuses total. That $12 million would pay for 150 legal services lawyers in Washington and double the number of operating legal services lawyers in the city. So the legal profession has the resources to do this. And in my view, I think the legal profession also has the obligation to do it. Certainly, the public has its responsibilities. Congress is funding it and should fund more. State legislatures should fund it. But it is ultimately, in my mind, a responsibility of the legal profession. Lawyers are not employees of corporations. They aren't making products. Lawyers are officers of the court who are sworn to uphold and strengthen the legal profession. That's their ethical obligation. It's the ethical obligation of the profession. Legal system, our judicial system, is our mechanism in this country for resolving disputes and for protecting the rule of law. And lawyers are failing in that responsibility if they are functioning as part of a system that fails to serve most Americans, and it does. There's a second reason why the legal profession has this responsibility, and it's because the legal profession has a monopoly on the practice of law. The legal profession controls who practices, how many people practice, what standards we have, controls the whole thing. And it's unconscionable that essentially public monopoly, one that has a monopoly over access to our legal system, is the gatekeeper of the legal system, is allowing into the legal system basically only those people who can afford to pay. So my own view is that it is the profession's responsibility. Now, the profession doesn't see it this way, obviously. The profession sees its responsibility here as urging Congress and others to support legal services. And when the profession talks about ethical obligations to serve the poor, it speaks of them only in individual terms. So if you look at the code, the model code of professional responsibility, it says that every lawyer is supposed to give 50 hours of pro bono work a year and make financial contributions also. Well, the people who wrote that, they have absolutely no idea whether 50 hours from each lawyer would make a difference. You just heard Goodwin's statistics. It's unlikely it'll come close. I think this problem won't be solved until the profession itself is willing to adopt as a professional obligation the responsibility to ensure that everyone has access to the legal system without regard to funding. Now, how would that happen? I suppose that's a different question with whether it will. If I were the president of the ABA, and God forbid that'll never happen, I hope it never will, I would convene the leaders of the bar, national, state, and local, and through whatever mechanism they have, I would urge the development of this declaration of responsibility. I would amend the code of professional responsibility, the model code, so that every lawyer's obligation, in addition to doing pro bono work, is to provide whatever financial support is needed to fulfill this goal in his or her community. And then I'd sit down with Jim Sandman and the other leaders of legal services, and I would come up with a plan to figure out how much money can we get from Congress, how much money can we get from other sources, and the legal service, the legal profession would produce the rest. I think, in my mind, that's the only way, at least short of major substantive changes in our legal system, that we're going to solve this, professionally embarrassing problem of the legal profession failing to serve most people in this country who can't afford it. Now, will this happen? I don't think so. I think the paper that Ben Heineman and David Wilkins and Bill Lee wrote is extremely important. I think everyone should read it. And now, if the legal profession and the corporate world and the academy responds to those suggestions and the values that they urge become dominant in the legal profession, then I think the profession could well take this responsibility on. But without the kind of, pretty dramatic changes that Ben and David and Bill are calling for, I don't see this happening, and I am sorry to say that notwithstanding all of these great ideas, which I truly hope that the Academy will follow up on and do everything we can to implement, because I don't have any doubt that they will improve the ability of poor people in this country to get legal services. My fear is that we will continue over the next few years to have conferences like this, because we will still have numbers like 70-80% of the poor people in the country can't get access to the legal system.
We may need to end on that not so positive note. But thank you very much, David. I think we're going to need to cut away pretty soon to our regional location. So I think what I'll do is just throw out some thoughts that may facilitate the discussions once we cut away. One question you might have is whether you agree with David that this is for the legal profession or whether you think this is for society as a whole. Another question you might ask is, do lawyers really make that much of a difference? You know, what is it that lawyers are doing for people that they can't do on their own? Because a great number of these people who cannot find a lawyer wind up in court on a pro se basis. And I'll add parenthetically that it's often unfortunate when that happens from my own perspective. Another question that some of you may have is just, you know, who are these folks who are eligible? I can quickly tell you they're people who earn 125% of the federal poverty line, who have an individual civil action, that's the legal services corporation model, and it's people who are charged of more serious misdemeanors and felonies that we're talking about on the criminal side. So we haven't had much of a chance to look at the criminal side, but the issue there is really caseload. People shouldn't be required to carry more than 150 felony cases a year, and yet you see numbers like 400, 500, in one extreme case, over 1,000, and they obviously can't in any meaningful way provide serious legal service to those clients, especially as is the case when they don't have experts, when they don't have investigators, when they're utterly blocked from really trying to do the kind of job they need to do. Another topic for, I think, our further discussion is whether technology, or to what extent is technology going to be the answer? It certainly, as Goodwin said, is going to play an important part, but many of the unrepresented are also living in a technology desert. They don't have internet at home. They don't have computers. They may not know how to use them. So how we bridge that gap is another question. And a final thing I would just throw out is whether another part of the solution may be partnerships with companies who might be willing, something along the line of the one-minute clinics you see in some drugstores, to donate a certain amount of space to perhaps having legal service desks so that the legal services people can come to where the clients are. There are many other questions. I'm sure that you all will have some of them, but I think it's time for us to stop this part and move on to our individual discussions. So, yes, so I now invite questions and comments from those of you who are here. There'll be a microphone for you. There
please
it is.
Please say your name.
I'm Richard Wilson. I've been one of the oldest members of the Academy about 1966, I believe. I think that there's a fundamental question in more than one country, and that's the relationship of what we're trying to do in society, and primarily in science and technology, as we mentioned, and then how we're going to cope with it in the legal situation. And I'd like to ask a question how this is going to be raised. And I'll give two examples which, to my personal knowledge, have given a conflict between the regulation and the technology. The first one is an old one in England of about 50 years ago. And there, it's well known in Harvard, we believe in innovation. And I have a picture of innovation outside my office. It's innovation made by my wife. And an innovation of a good Californian girl, by the way. And we raised a little cable between the front of our little cottage and the telephone pole on the cottage. And on that, we had a solar-powered clothes dryer. And this is innovation. It's better innovation than any other solar-powered clothes dryer I know of in this world. And incidentally, in California, where my wife came from, there are places where the legal situation, the local community refuses to allow this innovation because it's unsightly. They prefer windmills. And now, that is a question that's worth addressing, and I'd like to address how one addresses it, and that's primarily an American question. The second issue, which came to my attention, also to my attention, was if you ask yourself, it was primarily after the terrible accident at Chernobyl, people were trying to think what was happening next. And there's one very intelligent and bright man, Andrei Sakharov, who I got to know very well. And at the fundamental meeting, several meetings, he stood up and said, one of the major problems is the rule of law in the Soviet Union and the rule of law in Russia and the former Soviet Union. He regarded that as most important. However, he did not want that to overrule the advancement of technology. He said, we can't look backwards. We must support nuclear power, for example. Now, I just asked the question on the relationship between the science and technology which we were talking about, and your relationship with the law. How Where are the boundaries to be made? How are they going to be done? And is it different in Russia than it is in America?
Okay, this is a very big question, but I think maybe I'll say something first, which is certainly rule of law is a goal that we all strive for and that is very necessary for a successful society. Most of the things the people who are seeking legal services for are not quite at the level of how we're going to regulate nuclear power plants. They're looking not to be evicted from their home. They're looking to get veterans benefits. They're looking to get public service benefits. They're looking to avoid domestic violence. And so at an ordinary legal level, that's the kind of assistance they need. But maybe Goodwin or David wants to respond.
Well, but this is a rule of law issue. I mean, it's very much a fundamental, it's a different one than the one facing Russia, but it is a very fundamental rule of law issue in our country. And Judge Wood is exactly right that these are, you know, these are little legal issues, but they're big in the lives of these people. And if the people with these legal problems can't get access to the legal system, we have a serious rule of law problem. That's all.
Okay, take another question.
Go ahead.
It's often observed that in the United States, my name is Alan Altshuler. It's often observed that in the United States, we have many more disputes that go to law than in many other societies in Western Europe, for example. While certainly there's no question that we have terrible problems of access to the law for poor people who need it, another question is whether there's a possibility of significantly reducing burdens on the legal system by moving some activities out of litigious arrangements. Obviously, organized business is trying to move many of their disputes to arbitration in ways that are not necessarily so healthy for the rest of us. But I'd be interested in your thoughts on opportunities for reducing the burdens on the legal system.
Goodwin, do you want to take a shot at that?
Well, actually, I mean, if you look, I mean, I see Professor Judith Resnick is here from Yale Law School, and she could probably shout out the numbers. If you look in California, civil filings are declining. I mean, it's a shrinking docket. There's a lot of possible reasons for that. The accessibility of the system. I mean, well, I should just say, litigation is extremely costly, and nobody wants to have any part of it if they can possibly help it. Now, not only is it costly, now we've made it, lengthy. courts move incredibly slowly. We have, as deterrent, especially in small claim situations, a number of fees associated with it, and that's partly a result of courts declining funding. In so many ways, courts are no longer attractive places to resolve disputes. Now, you can go one of two directions with that fact. You know, you can go the direction of saying, well, then let's get everything out of court, which is what some actors, you know, have done. And then others have said, well, how can we improve what the performance of our courts? I think, you know, I'll just give you one anecdote, and I think perhaps Professor Resnick will like this one. This past summer, we had a trial in the San Francisco Bay Area. It was a gender discrimination trial involving a venture capital employee named Ellen Powell. I don't know, some of you may have heard of this trial. And I have to tell you, like, the trial was absolutely riveting. Every day I would, you know, go to whatever the website or news story was, and I'd just read, like, what happened in the trial. And it occurred to me that part of the reason it's so absolutely riveting is that we don't have very many trials. We don't have very many trials that actually produce evidence and spawn an important public discussion about an issue that otherwise would be, if it were arbitrated, would never see the light of day. And, you know, the fact is, those of you who follow that trial, Ellen Powell did not prevail in the trial, and indeed the evidence was, in my view, very close. But, you know, the significance of it went well beyond the parties, and that is the important aspect of why courts exist, because they are a public adjudication, disciplined according to procedure, and it becomes a touchstone for a conversation about what our rights and obligations towards each other should be. And indeed, you can surely imagine that in the setting in which that happens, Silicon Valley, venture capital, everybody was talking about this. And every HR person, every manager, you can be sure, was thinking about how to avoid having to be in this process in the future. And that in of itself is an important contribution of such a thing. And so I do worry, about our reaction yes, litigiousness is a problem, but we also have to think about what the public functions of litigation might be.
And there are many tools, actually, for dismissing, probably overused tools in some instances, for dismissing cases that had no business being filed to begin with. I like Goodwin, think the problem may be on the other side, because when you don't have a public trial, you lose also information about the law. You don't see what laws in a rich factual context mean, and most laws do require some kind of factual context to see what they mean. And of course, the public nature of trials and the like, and the fact that we try to the best of our ability, to level the playing field and give a hearing to those without resources just as good as the hearing that those with resources gets, isn't part of the promise of arbitration or anything else. Judith is going to say something.
Resnick, I thought I'd respond to the cold call. As I was listening, I did think it important in the context of the depressing quality of the vastness of the problem to underscore that it comes from the enormously cheerful news that all of us got to be rights holders. That the baseline in the 50s and 60s was that many of us in this room couldn't bring claims in terms of our juridical authority as individuals or in classes. And moreover, between 1960 and 1990, Congress created something like 400 more causes of action. There are more rights, and you could say there's either overregulation or the wrong kind of regulation, but the call for some form of authority to be understood as a rights holder is the good part of this. The same way that in the challenges of Gideon, the hard part was not the call for lawyers, but the vast ramp up in the numbers of criminal prosecutions. So over the last 50 years, there's been a remarkable increase in the demands on the criminal side, making it very difficult to meet Gideon's promise. And on the other side, an expansion on the civil side without, at the moment, yet a commitment to a civil Gideon that would be comparable. I think there's a cheerful story to tell about Gideon. If you go back to before 1963, there weren't public defender's offices around the United States. They're not where you'd want them to be, but there's more than there were. So I wanted to underscore the potential positive. And then the question is a political struggle over the public and the private, which is to say that while the New York Times give us an image of a mass number of arbitration clauses, there's actually not a mass number of arbitrations. California regulates arbitration providers, and what their data teaches us is that the company, the AT&T, which was the U.S. Supreme Court case about how we can't do, how an arbitration obligation could preclude us from bringing a class action, between 2009 and 2014, there were more than 100 million customers that AT&T had each year, but they're under 30 a year who bring arbitrations. So the question isn't moving it somewhere else. There are two questions. Is it going anywhere? And then is there public access to the it that is moving in any way? And I want to disconnect, and my suggestion in terms of the conversation partially is to disconnect the private, what kind of process happens with what kind of access to what kind of information. To add to David Tatel's call for the lawyers, I think I'd actually also ask where we could use government regulation, because a vast number of the kinds of problems you're describing are from failures to comply with law, at the low end. So there's this issue about how we could have public enforcement for compliance, which would also lower the demands.
I think that's a very important point, Judith, because actually the United States, more than any other country, relies on private enforcement of laws that other people might regard as public laws. And that's fine. I mean, it gives more enforcers, but it really shouldn't let the public enforcers off the hook. Other questions, comments?
There are some of us are from MIT, so we know something about technology. Now, what are the technological solutions that you propose? Is it analogous to avoid going to a library, or
well, that
is not enough, probably?
We had a fabulous presentation this afternoon by Harvard Law Professor David Wilkins, who was describing to us the enormous ramifications of how technology has invaded all other domains of our life. I guess I'll just mention a couple things because I want to make a broader comment about this particular issue. One thing, a narrow comment, is you mentioned libraries. Much of what law is about information. So the ubiquity, right, of this has to be kind of leveraged for the point of access. I mean, you know, poor people have this. And so there must be a way to enable, to use that connectivity to deliver information that is accurate, trustworthy, recent. That's what law is all about, you know, trying to get that kind of information in a usable format for ordinary people. I don't think we've yet explored the full extent of that. We, you know, typically what we have, I'll just speak from California's experience in terms of information assistance, you know, when people show up in the courthouse with any kind of dispute, small claims, eviction, divorce, whatever, there is still literally a physical library in the courthouse. And then we have these self-help centers, which have librarians, right, who are wonderful. I mean, some of them are attorneys themselves, and they can help direct the person often to computerized modules of information that help walk through forms or, go through the relevant provisions of law or whatnot. But, you know, that does seem a little antiquated in this day and age. Right? Shouldn't we be able to do that without a trip to the courthouse? Shouldn't we be able to do that in a personalized fashion because everyone's holding one of these things? I mean, so there's just lots of potential there. The second thing I'll just say is also piggybacking on what Professor Wilkins said this afternoon. One of the things I think we ought to do, and I'll say this because the Academy, of course, you know, all of you are scholars and you're in communication with your colleagues in the law schools, we ought to think very seriously about what we are teaching our law students and what we can do to integrate a course or some serious part of the curriculum to study the economics, history, and shape of the legal profession. I think it's weird, actually, that we focus law school almost entirely on substantive law areas. The first year curriculum has not changed in 100 years. It's still torts, contracts, you know, property, civil procedure. I mean, that's all important. No, don't get me wrong. We all should learn those things. But, you know, fundamentally, we're all going to be lawyers. And shouldn't we learn something about the nature of the profession, the economics of that profession, the way it's perceived, how well it's performing in the aggregate, all these issues about access to justice. And indeed, the question of technology, I don't think, is going to be solved by anyone other than the generation that's coming behind us. I mean, I'm, you know, only half a generation separated from the students that I teach, and I don't know a thing compared to them. And part of this is not just knowing the thing, but it's the usage, it's the patterns, that, and the way in which technology has changed our way of thinking. You can only have that by living it. And I think the people who are living it are, you know, the young people in this room. And so we have to create some spaces in the law school, in the curriculum or other places of education, where we are seriously engaging that part of their brains towards solving this particular problem.
David?
I've been mulling over an earlier question. I think it was Mr. Altshuler's question about why can't we avoid some of these legal disputes? And here's what occurs to me about that. You know, I'm not a legal services lawyer, and there are people here who are, but the fact is that many people who come to legal services offices or who need a lawyer, it's often over government benefits, welfare, food stamps, housing benefits, health care. It seems to me there's something wrong if our benefit programs are designed or administered in such a way that citizens need lawyers to benefit from them. Now, obviously, there are going to be cases that are difficult and you need a lawyer, but what's wrong with the design of our legislation and, perhaps more important, the bureaucracies that administer them that forces this? And shouldn't we be, and I think some of the people today may have mentioned this, we should be thinking deeply about how these programs operate and the culture of them that produces a situation where citizens need access to a lawyer to get a benefit that they're legally entitled to. Now, if we could focus on that, we could dramatically reduce the number of lawyers we need. And I wonder whether it would be useful for the academy or people working with it to look around the country at federal, state, and local programs and see whether there are some programs that that run without legal controversy. And if so, how do they do it? What have they accomplished? And maybe we could make some progress there.
That's a fantastic idea. I just to be concrete, too, we heard from legal services providers, they're doing everything from in large geographic areas using Skype or FaceTime to have initial client interviews to e-filing so that forms can just be filed from where you are to making, you know, even decisions or initial applications using the internet. And then over on the other side, there are a tremendous number of internet-based legal resources, I'll just call them. Some of them are controversial, but they're out there. You know, they're kind of the do-it-yourself group, and the legal profession is behaving a bit like King Canute if they think that they're going to make these things go away, because they're not. They're there. They're to be used and perhaps embraced in some way. So there's actually a lot going on even right now with technology. I think I have time for maybe one or two more questions. You had your hand up, so.
Yeah, I think it's important with respect to that last point Richard Zorza. It's important with respect to that last point to give credit to the Legal Services Corporation. The reality is at this point that I think, isn't it something like 20 times more people are assisted through technology than are assisted by direct brick offices? So we're actually already in that place, and legal aid has really been in the forefront of moving technology into the law. If I could just very briefly, I just wanted to make a comment about moving responsibility to the legal profession. It seems to me what's beautiful, elegant about that is that if you as a lawyer knew that you'd be making contributions to pay for access to justice, you'd be such a big supporter of innovations that improve the efficiency, including non-lawyer use.
Indeed.
Maybe,
one more? Yeah, let's pick up last comment. Okay, this lady. You have the last word.
I'm Marcia Angel. I'm at Harvard Medical School. And as these talks have gone on, I've thought about analogies with medicine, and in particular with physicians. Physicians have been paid, are paid, predominantly fee-for-service. And the more they do for well-insured patients, the more money they make. So what we have had in this country, what we still have, is a maldistribution of medical services. And some of us feel very strongly that physicians should be paid by salary and that they should be working in a nonprofit system. I'm wondering, when I hear you talk, it's almost like a throwback to the 1950s, where you wanted doctors to be really nice, and if a patient was poor, take care of them for free. It depended on this sort of noblesse oblige. It was not a part of the system. And I would like to see it a part of the system, so it is not kindness toward poor people, but what everyone gets who needs it. So I'm wondering how you would feel about salaries for lawyers, and maybe a single payer system for lawyers.
That's the kind of system I actually work in right now. It works fine for judges.
Yeah, it works fine for judges. Thank you all for your wonderful questions. Please join me in thanking.
Well, thank you, Diane, David, and Goodwin for a thought-provoking conversation, and thank you all for being with us this evening and for asking such good questions and thoughtful comments that deepened our exploration. I think Mort Mandel, if he's watching, would be very pleased that at the quality of the conversation we've had. It has been an honest conversation about a real problem in our democracy. But as the founders of the Academy imagined in 1780, we focused on positive steps that we can take, that we must take, to make our society more just and humane for all. The 2027th stated meeting of the American Academy is hereby dissolved.